Hello, good afternoon, and welcome to the panel Becoming Earth, Engineering Symbiotic Futures. I'm Daphne Tragona, I'm the conference curator of this year's Transmediale. At the conference of this 30th anniversary edition of the festival, we challenge ourselves by asking if and how we can speak of media today. So we're interested in this shift of media from being understood as connected to technical devices and means of communication to media expanding everywhere, becoming such an integrated part of our everyday lives that we can hardly grasp or feel their existence. And we wish to explore the changes that occur with the emergence of these new technomedial ecologies and hybridities, where it even becomes difficult to tell who or what is acting and where agency really lies. So one of the aspects that is of great interest within this context is this questioning of the primacy of the human. Is the human being decentered, as it is often being put, and what does that mean? This decentering can be understood in relation to the increased use of artificial intelligence and technologies of automation, but also in relation to the living environment, of course, and the impact of anthropogenic factors on Earth. So the title of this panel, I should say, is inspired by Braidotti's Becoming Animal, Becoming Earth, Becoming Machine, which is discussed in her book, The Posthuman, from 2013. And Braidotti sees this displacement of the human as necessary in order to go towards new modes of companionship and egalitarian coexistence. So we believe that this panel can greatly, in a way, exemplify this, as we will hear about technological systems and infrastructures that can be reimagined and repurposed to serve the living environment and non-human organisms and beings. I would like to introduce Valentina Karga, who will be our moderator for the panel. Valentina is an artist and architect based in Berlin. Her projects encourage engagement and participation and embrace practices of commoning, being connected with sustainability. As part of her work, Valentina has developed prototypes for autonomous living, and she has reimagined and staged alternatives for societal structures such as economic and pedagogic institutions. Valentina is a founding member of Collective Disaster, an interdisciplinary group that works in public space. Her work has been presented in the National Museum of Contemporary Art in Athens, in the Athens Biennial, the Chiasma Museum, other venues, but also, of course, here at the Transmediale Festival. In 2015, she was awarded, together with Peter Jan Grandry, the Willem Flusser Residency for Artistic Research. Thanks. Enjoy the panel.
Thank you, Daphne, for the introduction and for the invitation to be moderating this panel today. It's my great pleasure. And a warm welcome to all of you and, of course, to our guest speakers, to whom I will introduce you shortly. But first, I wanted to share also some thoughts about this panel, and especially when I heard the title of the panel, I couldn't help myself but thinking of this diagram. Andy, can you help me showing the diagram? Yeah, perfect. So I couldn't help establishing this link because I think it's one of the best examples I could find of an engineered symbiotic future, you know, coming like from a bit earlier times. So this is Graham Cain's Eco House, and it was designed by himself, but it was also built and inhabited by Graham himself in downtown London in 1972. So Graham studied the physiological cycle of humans, organisms, and machines, and based on that, he created this closed loop ecology. Using also the scientific advancements of that time. So in this diagram, we see Graham himself depicted more or less in the center, doing simultaneously a series of actions, like he's cooking, he's defecating in the biogas digester, he's showering, and he's monitoring some valves of the system. And with all this, it's kind of childish simplicity. I really like it because it shows one important thing, that he became integrated in the system he designed. So even though some of the system's streams pass through his very own physiology of his body, apart, I guess, from his mind and actions. So although he depicts also himself more or less in a very central position, he thus becomes one of these agents, one of these components that are important for this engineered system to function. And zooming into a little bit more into this act of indigestion, if you connect it to the fact that your body, that your bowels are actually is inhabited by 90% of non-human entities, like microorganisms, basically, you can start reading in this diagram more and more an overlap of visible and invisible symbiotic loops between human and non-human actors. Since today post-anthropocentrism displaces the notion of a single common standard for man as the measure of all things, opens thus the ontological gap not just for other species, but also, I think, a whole set of inorganic and immaterial actors to come in, leading us towards a planetary geocentered perspective. So I'm very excited to present you our speakers for today, from whom I think we will hear an update on how we regard these engineered symbiotic futures today. So our first speaker is Theun, I hope I pronounce it well, who studied fine arts at the Sandberg Institute in Amsterdam before joining FOAM, a translocal post-disciplinary platform for artistic research. His interests and experimental practice include experimental ecology, archaeology, and physics. He initiated Boskoi, the world's first smartphone app concerned with nature, and augmented ecology, where he keeps track of how nature is going online. And most recently, Machine Wilderness, a project investigating human technology from the perspective of landscapes by in situ prototyping sessions with varied transdisciplinary teams. And secondly, we have two Poles who will act as the spokesman of an augmented forest. And next to me, I have Paul Seidler, and who is an artist and interaction designer living and working in Berlin. Since 2013, he studies at the University of the Arts in the digital media class with Professor Joachim Soto. While studying, he worked at a range of research facilities, including the Design Research Lab and the Hybrid Platform. His projects and papers have been presented at LEAP Berlin, CTM, Touch Design Week, and EcoCore. And next to him, there is Paul Kolling, who is a media artist and designer living and working in Berlin. After spending some time working as a carpenter, he moved here to study visual communication, also with Professor Joachim Sota and UC Angus Leva. So he works at the intersection of media art, design research, and industrial design, and strives to explore the interaction between new materials, objects, and new technologies. So, Theun.
No. Thank you. I'm not sure if I can do this sort of Obama thing of speaking to both sides, because I'm also trying to concentrate on where I am. But if I tend to be a bit like this, don't feel ignored, please. I've been I'm very happy to be here. Thanks for the invitation. I've been interested for a number of years in how the role of human technology is sort of changing in our environment. And I've been sort of just looking around. My interest was generated because it seemed to the gathering environmental data seemed to be shifting out of its sort of classic context of academia and science and moving more into the public domain. And I thought, that's quite interesting, because that's a much wilder place for this data to exist in. And so I just started to look around what is happening there. And it's surprising, actually, to see how many sensor networks and all these kinds of things are in our environment, on our mountains and in our lakes, in our oceans. There's a huge amount of stuff. Basically, we live on a quantified planet already, and it's not just sort of things on the end of a stick. That sensor, how many clouds are overhead, or you know, it's all kinds of different contributing systems, and animals are a part of that too. And I got interested in that specifically at first. So you have animals like this narwhal, and the sensor is almost like a flea of the Anthropocene. It's sort of on the animal, and it's and then its host goes through its environment, and then we get the data. In this case, the narwhal is a good host because it goes to all kinds of depths of the ocean. So to study the effects of climate change on different depths of the ocean, this was a really good idea to do it. And so these animals have moved in a way from helping us harvest our fields to helping us harvest data. And over the years of looking at these sort of changes, I started to feel like we were in a bigger process, like nature was going online, and we were sort of already in the final stage of that. There wasn't really a debate that was very prominent about that. There were a bit of there were some skirmishes when, for instance, the national parks in North America wanted to introduce Wi-Fi into all national parks, because they said that will improve safety for people. If you fall on one of our mountains and you break your leg, then you should be able to reach out. But there were also real, you know, wilderness advocates who said, no, Wi-Fi is the last thing I want in my wilderness. I want to be removed. I want to be in a free zone. The wilderness is also a political free zone where we should be able to hide, where we cannot be tracked. So there's these there's an interesting debate, I think. And one of the images that I saw that convinced me I was onto that I was onto something was an image that surfaced on Twitter in May 2014. And it's an image taken on the back of a safari vehicle. And it's a warning for people who make photographs to, when they upload their photographs made in the wild park, to not include GPS data, because poachers are using that data. You know, they're sort of hunting the rhinos online, on Instagram and Flickr. So if there ever was a clear distinction between a sort of technosphere and biosphere, it certainly wasn't there now, at that moment. And what's also interesting about, what I found interesting, is that some systems that we make, some of our technologies, were never intended to be connected to environmental issues or gathering scientific data, but still they have an effect, like GPS data in photographs. And 2014 was really the year of big changes. That's the year when drones came out, and the first drone legislation was set in place for national parks, and drone hunting became banned. First tried out and then banned. And so a lot happened then. But more recently, I noticed, well, it's probably a longer trend, but autonomous systems seem to be popping up a lot recently. And so you're living in a kind of world where a group of elephants, a herd of elephants, is shadowed by a flock of autonomous drones that can self-launch and which can decide by themselves which kinds of sensors they need to perform a mission of monitoring or protection against poaching, or where coral reef is being patrolled by a robot that hunts the invasive species that threaten that coral reef, or where a kind of robotic plant in a sort of group of robotic plants spread through a rainforest are listening to the biodiversity of frogs. You know, it's a kind of machine wilderness. And this machine wilderness was the theme of ICEA in 2012. And it became the working title of a project, a sort of research program, looking into what does it actually mean when our technologies almost appear in the landscape as organisms do, as animals. And it first was just a working title, but you know, you start writing applications and doing things, and then before you know it, it's a definite title. But I was in contact with the curator of ICEA, Andrea Polli, about it, and I just, you know, agreed to just always refer back to the original source of that. And so I think these autonomous systems are an interesting step if you look at the history of human technology more general. And here comes my central point. Well, slowly. That longer history starts actually quite far back. And early pioneers like Al-Yazari were making quite complex, programmable automata and robotic creatures, or they wouldn't call it robots, but mechanic birds and things like that, already in the early 13th century. And then with the Industrial Revolution, the machine really comes to dominate the landscape dramatically. And that's the word that comes to mind when I think about that is brutality. You know, it's that's not a happy relationship. And so in all of these centuries where we've lived together in in landscapes filled with all kinds of different creatures, snails, frogs, birds, kangaroos, all kinds of things. And all these things have their own perspective on existence. And all that time we've designed the our technology in that shared space really for one type of ape. I think when you think about that, that's really ridiculous. And from a design perspective, that's also really quite boring. So that became sort of the that's sort of the starting idea. Because in my lifetime, wildlife has been reduced globally by 50%. That's, you know, that's quite dramatic. And I don't want. So we basically say, fuck loneliness. We don't. I don't want to be just with humans are nice, but we don't want to eradicate all the other ones. So Edward Wilson called this age of biodiversity loss the age of loneliness. And I think our technology, a long part until recently, our technology has been a technology of loneliness. Not just in intention, but also in effect. And, well, how do you then design something that is not just for humans and that addresses complexity and biodiversity and all these, you know, layers of communication in the landscape or the entirely different energy regimes that nature operates at? How do you do that? And I'm not an engineer. I don't know any of the answers to these questions, but I thought, let's make it into a program. I was invited by a curator called Alice Smits, and together we developed it, Machine Wilderness, into a program. And the center of that is fieldwork. Fieldwork where we go to specific locations, and we, we selected sort of four places in Europe, and the idea was to get a nice sort of spread, so we get a sort of overview of Europe in a way. So it ranges from northern Finland to the Mediterranean, and from strict nature reserve to real just urban landscape. And the idea for that spread was that every place is important, you know, equally important. So a plant that's growing on the outside of this of this building is in the same struggle as maybe a magnificent tree in the rainforest. It's as soon as we start to make distinctions that rainforests I don't know, these plants are important too, and hybrid zones are important, and even plants in the middle of our urban zones are important. We need all the biodiversity. So, and it's just more interesting to look at all kinds of different places. So we started with lots of people. Yeah, this is more going into the sort of design, how to frame that in design. I don't know anything about design, but I sort of talk to people. And but this image I found quite nice, a guy building a huge elephant. I think we started with smaller things. This I'll also skip. It's sort of the history of AI, where first artificial intelligence was building thinking machines, basically just, you know, a computer, something that computes. Then the shift goes to something that is embodied. We're sort of in that now, but their researchers in AI are finding that when they make these embodied machines, they're the environment that they're in is actually the main influence on, you know, the environment calls for the embodiment which sort of brings out the intelligence. And we thought let's start with environment. And the most complex environments we know in the universe, that is ecosystems on planet Earth, and we just selected a few for field work. So what we do is we go out with a huge group of mixed people. We're trying to and sort of open up to wherever we are. And so it's really basically just being a bit modest, shutting up and listening. That's the sort of simple, short way to explain that. Then we form teams. Teams go out on a hike. During that hike, the landscape will somehow suggest some sort of idea. An initial idea will form within the group. And then the group works together to sketch that out physically. Sometimes these sketches happen just in one afternoon. But it's a physical thing. It's really trying to build something. And the idea of building it is to try and flesh out as much of the reality of it as possible. So it's beyond the drawing, but sometimes not much beyond a drawing. The end of that process is to release the creature in the habitat it was made for. So where the initial idea popped up is where it's released, like you release a ship and you throw the bottle of champagne against it. So sometimes it's really simple, like this sort of sort of cuttlefish model. And sometimes it's more evolved, like that prototype that Ian Ingram made in Finland in one of the later sessions, where we had spent more time. That robot can recognize crows and then tries to communicate with them. And sometimes, you know, it's epic, and sometimes when you introduce something, it drowns in within seconds. So you experience all the emotions. I think it's a bit like a parent, maybe. I don't know. And so it's based on observation, experimentation, and we try out design methods. That feeds into discussion, like hopefully today, and we try and present to broad audiences, so to reach not just experts, because in a way there are not really experts yet for this. So that's a good thing too. Anybody can sort of enter this debate at the same step. And some key insights, well, they may not be that key because I don't remember many of them, but from memory I remember the top one, which is embrace not knowing. So to accept that maybe we don't know and we're not that much in control, because it seems a bit making a robot that can participate in an ecosystem, that is super ambitious. When you look at our track record, we can't really even control a plastic bag. You know, if that forms huge chemical soups in the ocean. So something as complex as a robot, we can try, but I don't expect people to take it very seriously, other than an attempt to really communicate or really sort of engage with the complexity. So that's my main underlying question. It's also the top one, which is, do we really know what it means to participate in an ecosystem? That's an open question for me. I'm from Holland, and that's basically a few hundred kilometers of green concrete. And you know, participating in an ecosystem would, you know, we shouldn't over romanticize that, because that could also mean tolerating the tiger around your village. And I know in Holland it's already quite something to tolerate the mole in your lawn. And so I'm not sure it's really in my culture to tolerate or to be sort of part of an ecosystem. I've grown up in an ecosystem that's almost barren. So, next steps I want to do, sorry, my text got a bit mixed up, is field work. I want to continue these sort of field work sessions because it's really where the action is. And I think it's important to go out of an environment that's completely sort of aimed at us and to really engage with specific local situations. And actually the character of the place doesn't really matter that much as long as we can move around freely. And then that would feed into an exhibition coming up. You know, I'm talking about it with the Amsterdam Royal Zoo to sort of they're in a transition, and in that transition many of their enclosures are empty, so it would be nice to sort of use that and show these sort of mechanic animals in between the organic beings. And then tomorrow there's going to be a workshop that I do with behavioral ecologist Matthew Creasy. And we're going to look at creatures that live around here. What's happening in the lives of creatures around here? How do you actually know what's happening in the life of an animal? So observation techniques. And ecologists are trained in that. So I'm hoping that Matthew can really point us at ways to do that. And then can an integrated design be based on the way a local animal goes about its daily business and solves its problems and how it tackles its issues? And that's the idea for that workshop. So thank you.
Thanks for the introduction and thanks for the invitation. We are here to present a project we are currently working on almost now for, I would say, 6 months probably. And I will first start to talk a little bit like autonomous software agents, but it will tie back then later back to nature and ecology systems. But I think this is quite important to kind of like grasp the whole scope of the project. So to understand the origins of Terra Zero, it's important to discuss the relationship between like non-human actors and capital via decentralized technologies. Cryptocurrencies like Bitcoin enable the possibility of programs to administer capital through the lack of verification of a human user. The only requirement for a Bitcoin wallet is a working operating system with enough memory, which doesn't need to be a personal computer, but rather can be a virtual machine running on an Amazon server. What was before a commercial practice operating only in stock exchanges is now freely available through cryptocurrencies. In July 2011, the user Jules opened a thread on Bitcoin Talk called Bitcoin the Enabler, truly autonomous software agents roaming the net, in which he proposed for the first time an autonomous agent which could administer capital. I will just quote him. For the first time, there exists a possibility for a software agent to roam the internet with its own wallet. Using Bitcoin, it could purchase the resources it needs to survive, hosting, CPU and memory, and sell services to other agents or to humans. To be truly effective and survive out there on the net, long term, you would probably need some basic AI and the ability to move itself between service provider occasionally. But even a relatively dumb agent might survive for a while. Furthermore, while there are no specific implemented examples of autonomous agent yet, besides probably computer viruses, Vitarik Buterin and Gavin Woods developed in 2013 the concept within their Ethereum white paper, a next-generation smart contract and decentralized application platform. In this, they describe complex programs which can administer capital with a certain set of rules. The concept of smart contracts was initially proposed by the computer scientist Nick Szabo to merge discipline of contract law with e-commerce protocols in 1993. Smart contracts are computer protocols that verify and enforce the performance of a contract. While Maxwell and Jules thought of systems which could administer Bitcoin, their programs would still run local. So the introduction of smart contracts by Buterin and Woods, decentralized and censorship-resistant programs were enabled to gain and hold capital, programmable wallets saved in the blockchain. In 2013, Vitalik Buterin developed this concept further within Bootstrapping a Decentralized Autonomous Corporation, Part 1. Buterin attempted therein to develop a conceptual framework for an autonomous corporation. However, there's a very interesting questions arise. Do we really need the people? The question is, can we approach a problem from the other direction? Even if we still need human being to perform certain specialized tasks, can we remove the management from the equation instead? He then further tries to build a reference system in order to properly categorize different organization models. These categorizations of organization models seem incomplete and overlapping, as the title already suggests. Buterin claims that once an intelligent agent operating on decentralized infrastructure is granted control over an amount of capital, the system in question is not merely an AI controlling capital, but an artificial, intelligent, decentralized, autonomous organization. Furthermore, like the science fiction author Carl Schroeder kind of asked the really important question, do you think like decentralized autonomous systems could be used by our non-human ecosystems in a thread, which was called Theun, Decentralized Autonomous Corporations for Natural Systems. And I just gonna quote him. The rather simply question underlying this idea, why stop at corporations at persons? Rivers, watersheds, coral reefs, mountain biomes, all could be represented by decentralized autonomous corporations and the goods and services they provide defined in their charter. By extracting the defining criteria laid out by Jules, Maxwell, and Buterin and applying them to the idea posited by Schroeder, we define Terra Zero as a decentralized autonomous corporation for natural systems according to the 5 criteria. The decentralized autonomous corporation is in control over natural resources and natural infrastructure. The decentralized autonomous corporation earns enough money to maintain itself without human intervention. For the example, the duck pays for its own server space. I will just call it duck for like make it a little bit shorter. The duck has an adaptive feedback system. When interacting with humans, the duck does so as a peer, not as a tool. The duck can replicate itself and is able to gain control over more resources and infrastructure.
So, if we try to build a framework for a decentralized autonomous corporation representing natural systems, we have to reconsider them as user in the technosphere. Wilhelm Flusser's work in Dinge and Undinge undermined the diametric conceptualization of nature and culture. Since human understanding of the natural, that which is neither affected nor produced by human, can only occur by the tools of culture, such as art and science, the natural cannot be separate from culture. Thus, everything is infected kind of by culture. The need, highlighted by Flusser, to account for and interact with entities outside of the anthropomorphic frame has been granted serious urgency by the work of Benjamin Bratton. If we understand the world's technology as information, it quickly becomes apparent that artificial entities traverse this world far better than we do. This world far better than we carbon-based entities do. However, the inability of the human in the world of artificially intelligent ecological agents we have outlined here can be resolved. Luciano Floridi's notion of the infork, whereby agents should be understood merely as differently enabled, interconnected informational organisms, mirrors the breakdown of the nature-culture divide by removing the binary aspect of the human-non-human divide. We are all different tokens of the type infork, to refer again to Breton Stack, all different tokens of the type user, for example, animal user, AI user, or natural system user. We can level the playing field by understanding ourselves as human inforks, interacting with Terra Zero as an augmented organism infork or an augmented forest infork. Removing the dichotomous conceptualization of nature and culture opens up space for non-humans to act in with world biotechnology. Talking about decentralized autonomous corporations representing natural systems raise questions regarding non-human ownership. Property describes the most comprehensive form of a possession of a thing or material or immaterial good due to its operating at the legislative level. Features of modern legally defined forms of property are the assignment of material or immaterial goods to legal entity, the recognition of the arbitrary rights of the owner, and the demarcation of the limits of owner discretion. One also discusses property as a bundle of rights which symbolize the economic and power relations existing between persons. Property thus operates in the legal, economic, and social sphere simultaneously, and is defined through the allocation of a material and immaterial good to real person or agent. Blockchain technology and smart contracts enable non-human agents to administer capital and therefore to claim the right to property for the first time. Property, however, is primarily discussed at the present time as something which is not separable from a natural or legal entity. Terra Zero begins in this legal gray area, originating in the technological change brought about with the invention of blockchain technology and smart contracts. Since an individual's property is protected in accordance with the rights, one would assume that objects which have gained the right to property are entitled to similar personal rights as natural persons. Although the European Parliament has drafted a proposal for classifying working robots, for example, as economic persons, this appears to pertain solely to discussion of tax. Answering questions related to this notion of robotic economic person, such as how to properly tax a DAO, will require discussion non-human agent as property owners. In a sense, it appears that an European Union-wide discussion of non-human agents as having property rights, as being in some sense legal persons, appears to be on the horizon. So, coming from a conceptualization of decentralized autonomous cooperation as proxies for natural systems, able to use and own technological and ecological resources, we propose Terra Zero. It's a concept of a self-owned forest and an ongoing art project that strives to set up a prototype of a self-utilizing piece of land. From an economic perspective, an entity cannot be separated from its purpose nor function. Thus, the means of existence of every entity is based on its usability by third parties. A forest has an exactly computable productive force. The market value of the overall output of the forest can be precisely calculated. Besides its function as the source of raw material, the forest also holds the role of service contractor, for example. Terra Zero creates a framework whereby a forest is able to sell licenses to lock its own trees through automated processes, smart contracts, and blockchain technology. In doing so, the forest accumulates capital. A shift from valorization through third parties to self-utilization makes it possible for the forest to procure its real exchange value. And with this capital, it buys itself from a project initiator and back and thus owns itself. The augmented forest as owner of itself is in the position to buy more ground and therefore to expand.
Yeah.
Okay.
We will now show you some slides which explaining schematically different feedback systems embedded in Terra Zero, or which are we building at the moment and try to embed them in Terra Zero. This will include like a capital flow, the informational flow, the smart contract architecture, and the internal capital flow. They are particularly incomplete and might interleave. So, in the first phase of the project, the forest will be purchased by the initiators. A smart contract contain all contractual definition will be then drawn up. This contract serves as a representation of the whole system, regulating its exploitation in accordance with a certain set of rules. When a contract is drawn up, the forest will be signed over to it. Terra Zero is then indebted to the project initiators. This debt will be represented by Terra Zero tokens, as you can see in the diagram. At this stage, the initiator holds all Terra Zero tokens representing its debts. In the second phase of the project, a predetermined economic model embedded in the smart contract will control the material exploitation of the forest. Terra Zero will sell licenses to lock certain trees, and if a certain sum of money is earned via selling these licenses, Terra Zero will begin to repay the initiators by buying its Terra Zero tokens back. Once repayment is complete, the project initiator will hold no more Terra Zero tokens, making the forest the sole shareholder of its economic value. The forest, in economic terms, controls itself. At this point, it's an economic unit, which acts autonomously. Through appropriation of capitalist and cultural mechanics, the forest gains and controls over its economic interaction. The forest is no longer a source of material to be utilized by third parties, but instead interacts with them as a peer. Therefore, Terra Zero can be seen as a prototype of an autonomous economic unit in a post-human future. A remote sensing device, this could be, for example, a satellite provider or a drone, gathers information about the forest. This information, so there's a number, age and health of the trees, is fed back into the oracle. The oracle then updates the smart contract with this information. The oracle can be seen as a program or bot running either on owned hardware or third-party infrastructure. The smart contract then calculates the number of trees available to be locked according to a given set of rules. It generates licenses to lock trees in form of Terra Zero tokens, which can be acquired through the user. The user pays the smart contract for licenses and is now entitled to lock the purchased trees. This diagram is actually a simplification of the actual code, which can be found at Terra Zero GitHub, and which you can look at if you want. And it doesn't explain the whole token and ownership model, which are also embedded in the code, but have been left out here for simplicity. So the contact has a database which receives information from the oracle about the trees. When triggered by the oracle, the smart contract can compute with the help of this database how many logging licenses it can sell in form of Terra Zero tokens. This decision is based on certain criteria. We will talk about these criteria later because they are quite important. Such as age, health, and size of the trees. It generates these tokens, which can be acquired through the user. You can also see on the side like a simple decision tree iterating over the database. And of course, the smart contract has to pay for both its own hardware facilities and for the trusted information of the remote sensor in order to keep the system running. These hardware facilities host the oracle, which feeds information to the remote sensor.
Okay. To test the concept, we are realizing the project on a small scale. While we wanted to usually buy a proper forest, we came across numerous problems due to our limited budget and the bureaucratic complexity of official channels, at least here in Germany.
It takes like 6 months to
like only the paperwork.
Yeah.
And so we ended up collaborating with someone who already has a small forest and is interested in setting up a Terra Zero prototype. And here you can see our actually contract of the right of usage for the forest. The forest with which we are working now has a total size of approximately like 1,200 square meter. It's pretty small. And it's located close to Rüdersdorf, 30 kilometers in the east of Berlin. It's composed mainly of pine trees, ranging from young, 5 years old, to 40 years old. Stefan Sader, the owner of the forest, was willing to take a part in our project as the initiator. And it might be that he's here, but we're not sure, actually. We'll see afterwards in the discussion. The first conceptualization of the project involved the remote sensing function being performed via computational analysis of satellite images. However, while evaluating different satellite providers, the excessive cost of high-resolution image data became an issue. The ability to evaluate the satellite image data was also an issue, since it's dependent on factors like weather, snow or cloud cover, for example, makes computational analysis nearly impossible. Therefore, we're experimenting with camera drones, to get back to the drone thing, to get the visual material of the forest and the location of the trees. We are currently testing, among other things, the possibility of drone automation through GPS waypoints. And another possibility would be an on-demand service, which includes collecting the location data just manually. Yeah, and at the moment we are also experimenting with different methods of tree mapping based on GPS data and image recognition. And this is a satellite image of our actual forest with an overlaying with our manually collected GPS data of our actually trees.
So there you can see that the image is not the Google image. I mean, the satellite image is a Google image and this is not accurate anymore because it was like probably it's from 2009 or something. Yeah.
But since there's need for hardware anyways, for example, where the Oracle is running and to support the drone, why not build Terra Zero infrastructure in the scope of its operation? This is the Terra Zero station. It's a partially automated drone landing station and a server which performs the image analysis and runs the Oracle. The station will be located in the middle of the forest, and the top section of the station is the landing station, which can also cover the drone and therefore protects it while it's not in use. In the bottom section, the server and all the electronics needed to open and close the station, charge the drone, and the battery to store the energy generated by solar panels are located. By the end of March, we will release, hopefully, an alpha version of the system working with the forest. It will consist of the smart contract, the code for which is already written and can be found on our GitHub, and it currently gets tested on private Ethereum blockchains, and a prototype of the Terra Zero infrastructure.
We also have some conclusion. So Terra Zero kind of wanted to provide a framework for a self-utilized piece of land. And for simplicity, our first prototype will judge and work with simple economic criteria. The aim of the project was simply to set up a working system or try to conceptualize a working system and not necessarily define the numerous criteria needed to allow for the variety of natural systems. And there, further research needs to be done by biologists, ecologists, and probably also philosophers to evaluate the usability of decentralized programs for proxies for ecosystems. Furthermore, this opens up to a lot of questions. How do we categorize these new spheres of activity in which future economic, or how do we categorize these new spheres of activity in which future economic activities would become detached from human labor that created them? Could this framework help forest conservation efforts where human labor is severely underfunded? And does this project, even if it tries to escape the trap, is still like anthropomorphizing a lot, maybe? And if this is built in larger scale, to whom does the structure ultimately serve? besides the realization we are kind of working on, we applied also together with like FZE, a research center for informatics, and Inter3 and the Wuppertal Institute, which are also research centers for resources, in order to set up iterations of the Terra Zero framework. These potential iterations will also raise questions regarding the criteria on how to these systems, or how the criteria of the system should be defined. We're currently also co-writing a scientific paper which will also refer to iteration of Terra Zero together with FZE. At the moment, we are a core team of three, which includes Mark Hampshire, who is also here in the audience, and who is currently writing the second iteration of like this whole concept paper, and helped us a lot with this presentation. I just want to say, if you got interested in the project and want to participate, either as an initiator, which means you probably have forest, or as a developer, or probably also as a lawyer, we might need like a lot of lawyers also, then feel free to get in touch with us. Yeah, I think that's it.
Thank you so much to all three of you. Great presentations. I have a question that relates immediately to what you were just saying. And I was thinking that, you know, a forest is a finite resource. It will finish at some point. So is there a parameter that prevents the forest of a very fast, complete self-exploitation?
Is this on? Yeah, okay. Yeah, that's actually a really good question, because that's what we're talking about kind of when we're talking about the politics which are embedded in the system. And there needs to be like a lot of research done by ecologists and like people who really know how like natural systems like regenerate and stuff. So at the moment we kind of just built in like a range where the program is then saying, okay, you can lock this tree because this tree might become dangerous for the whole system because it's too old now and might just basically ruin other like trees or something like this. But this is like a really simplified version, so it really needs to kind of like develop this criteria when a tree should be locked down. This needs a lot of work. Yeah.
Maybe I use. Yeah, okay. In relation to your question, I think the forest is an endless resource or limited resource. I'm not sure. It's a dynamic system. So at the moment it's forest, but you know, there's this way of ecosystems shifting into other stages and becoming different kind of things, and there's initial vegetation that sort of pioneering vegetation, and then it sort of builds up to climax vegetation. That's a sort of classic interpretation of ecology, and I've talked to people who are trying to build these food forests, and they're thinking in centuries. And so for Holland, the classic, what ecologists think is our ultimate stage of an ecosystem is oak forest. But we're not sure, because nothing has been around long enough ever in, you know, the last hundreds of years to know if anything comes after an oak forest. So I think you should be open-minded about what is there. And and it's interesting to see how you deal with the dynamics of that. I like it to see what these trees are doing, and like you say, if an individual tree gets too old, does that warrant you intervening? I don't know. But when you were talking about drones, it also made me think about these drones that help to plant forests. And you need a lot of lawyers then too, I guess, because these drones fly around and they shoot seeds into the ground, so you don't want to be walking there when the trees are being planted. But I could see sort of a second flock of drones.
I was actually thinking about this this parameter of time, you know, maybe this forest sells its own contents in a very slow process that is imperceptible by a human by the human mind.
Hello? Okay. Actually, there's like this phenomena from, like, I think it comes from that, in at least in Germany, a lot of forest is owned by like families, and nowadays it's not like your normal workplace that you own a forest and to take care of this forest. But so there's this fact that I think in like a rhythm of every three generation, it happens that the forest just get really hardly destroyed, and maybe like 90% of all the trees get logged. And it, I read about it, and I just don't remember the name who wrote it, but he explained it like this: that if you have like a forest, then it's like a lot of work to, you have to put a lot of effort into it, that it grows and that it stays like it is. And then there's the next generation which gets the forest from the parents, and they know how much effort the parents put into the forest, but they don't put any more effort into the forest, but it just stays like it is. And then there's the third generation which knows nothing about it and just says, okay, it's an opportunity to make like quick money, and just like cuts down like 90% of the trees. And then there's usually the fourth generation who has like this idea and gets like, maybe listens to old stories, or I don't know, but starts to replant the forest again. And so, for example, this could be like the Terra Zero could be also a framework to prevent this, just to have like a more stable economic use of forests.
All right, so does anybody have any question? Yeah, we already have somebody there. There is a microphone.
Hi. What happens when the forest is free and is still earning money? I mean, could you imagine that the forest starts to buy, for example, Volkswagen stock, and whatever decision does the forest then make on the stock?
At least at the moment, I think you have to put somewhere into the code all the possible future interactions. So if there's no future interaction to buy like Volkswagen stacks, then I don't think so. But yeah, I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, it's an interesting question. I think we kind of thought that at one point you can maybe like sell also other forest to the forest, so that he is then just expanding. But on the other hand, I mean, we're talking here about like ranges of like probably like 90 or 100 years. So yeah, it's an interesting question, but it's really more like a speculative question, because it takes like really long in like practice till the forest is kind of like bought itself.
I mean,
it depends on the parameters, but.
On long-term perspective, you could program a political intention in the action of the forest, right?
Yeah, I mean, that's what we were talking about, that it really needs a discussion about like what kind of these parameters should be. But I mean, I think that's a discussion which needs to be with every program or with everything, because you always embed kind of like a political ideology in something, so if you like build it.
So does it make the forest then half artificial and half natural, or?
Does this relate to the question before?
No.
Okay. That's a good question. I mean, I mean, the category is probably also like a little bit like dualistic, or like, I mean, I wouldn't say it's like total, I mean, yeah, I don't know.
I think we
I mean, we try to overcome these categories, actually. So
it doesn't matter.
That's the whole idea about the post-human discourse, no? It's to overcome the dualism, good and bad, this or that,
thanks,
we, the forest, right?
Will you also be including services? That's a big discussion in the environmental sort of corner of the world. Should we be sort of monetizing the services that ecosystems provide?
I think at the moment not, but we have like this the problem that we, I think it's a quite complex concept like at the beginning, and we have all, we thought about like maybe like having like a place for camping and stuff, and different other possibilities just to monetarize other aspects of the forest, but then we thought, okay, I think we have to make just like one really pure prototype of this just to explain the basic concept, because otherwise it just gets a bit too confusing. And then there are like other iterations which arose from the Terra Zero project, for example, the project with FZE, which could be like more open for other possibilities.
But I think it's really like an interesting idea or like interesting speculations to think about like what would happen if you would actually have to pay like the ecosystems you kind of like using in your environment, and how would this kind of like relate to like your consumption of like stuff. So
your talk also made me think of these. You have these crazy millionaires, and when they die, the cat inherits the whole thing. So a cat can sometimes inherit, or a dog inherit, a company or a fortune, you know? How is that different from what you're trying to do? Maybe should your forest inherit a company from a mad millionaire?
Yeah, I mean, the problem is like there's this whole like legal problem that like...
Ah, yeah.
You can basically not, there is no like way of like giving ownership to something which is not like a legally person, basically.
It first so has to be this sort
it
of
first
standard.
It first has to be basically a corporation. Since
yeah. So you could be those people, and then you could sort of defer it to the forest.
That's kind of like the idea.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Question over there.
Hi, thanks for the nice talk. Before, like, right now we're talking about forests, but like in your presentation you also mentioned like mountains, rivers, etc., etc. And I kind of wonder like how and why would you decide on a forest being an autonomous agent and not a tree? I don't know, like maybe create like a company for an ant or something. Like that's the first question. And the second question would be like, what if you have like interfering autonomous corporations, you know, like what if the river buys the forest and does bad stuff to it? I don't know, you know, like, because like the river might be in the forest. So what happens in that case? Or like the forest is on the mountain, you know, so you have like different competing natural autonomous corporations against each other.
You want to say something? Yeah, I mean, like, first the second question. I think that's like really, really interesting question and really interesting speculation. And I think there we're going into the question of like governance, like, or like how, like, who is like having like authority in this case, and I think these are like questions we don't like basically worked on, to be honest. And I think it might be that this project opens to such questions. And what was the first question again? Sorry.
How to decide on working with the forest and not the single tree, for example?
Oh, actually, we decided with the forest because we thought the forest is kind of like a tangible. It has like the most like tangible resources, if you want so. So, I think We kind of did it for like simplicity, actually. Yeah.
And actually, is a single tree, it's like a bit hard to say, okay, which is the exact area which is like from the tree. So, and what happens if there's like another tree popping up from the ground, like just because there was like a semen falling down on the ground. So I think it was just simpler. And it just like, it made like the whole process of like accumulating capital a bit faster, which is not fast at all in the end, but it was like a bit like a human, more like in a human time reference.
Thanks.
This, by the way, thank you all. This is wonderful. This may actually be quite connected, and because I think from your description of the system that you're talking about, it seems like there's almost a problem even in defining what the forest is, because the question sort of becomes not even is it the river against the forest, but is the forest a single species of tree? Is it the animals in the forest? Is it, and so that actually brings up an interesting question of really asking what it is that you're talking about. And it seems to me like it almost becomes that your forest is the program running in that little ball that sits in the middle that decides what to do with the space around it. But maybe you guys can speak to that a little bit. I don't know if that.
Yeah, I mean, like the first, or I see like kind of like two questions there. So the first thing regarding like models, I think it's like really, of course, it's really hard like to determine like what the forest is, or maybe you can say something.
It's a fair point.
Yeah, you kind of.
There's
so
not really an answer, I think.
Yeah. So and if you like take models or if you build stuff, you always kind of like oversimplificate stuff, right? So in a way, we're kind of building a model, building like the thing for a model of a forest, right? So I think there's really this like problem. Of course, like a forest is like so rich in like certain like agencies which are not included in our model at all, because it would be just like too complex. So I think this is like a fair point that this is like an oversimplification of the concept. Yeah. At the moment, not.
But I think the first one would be just to set up like an interdisciplinary team from like biologists, philosophers, ecologists, and because we're like, if you want to say, we're like artists, we had like this idea and we want to set up a framework which can be like recycled and reused by other people.
Which actually might happen. So there might be like more like scientific research on this like idea. So yeah, hopefully this will then like serves more in the direction of like having a diverse vision of like what a forest can be.
Then he already asked this question through his presentation, no? How to design for complexity. It was one of your.
How to design for complexity? Well, that's hard to answer in a sort of abstract way. But so that's why we go to specific places. You have a specific place, and the way you forest is a human word, but the place you have is it's that reality and. Maybe, yeah. It's hard to. I guess it's a matter also of legal framing, but it's hard to say where the tree begins and where the soil begins, or where also for us you breathe air, but actually that's quite a profound experience where you realize that actually is one big thing. And
well, from a quantum physics perspective, there is no you and me and the space in between us, but it's actually a whole a network of interconnected energies. We just perceive ourselves as solids due to our limited senses. So.
Also in slightly more accessible fields of science to direct perception. That's, you know, we can have that experience ourselves also. Mm. But a friend of mine has worked in the rainforest for 20 years, and when she writes a text, she first reads it to the trees. And it's not really an idea that they will hear her, but somehow it does help her to really read out the thing, and then if something is not really right in there, she will feel it then. So maybe you should just also present your plan to the trees and whatever else is there. I'm sure it's not just trees.
But there were two more questions here, and we don't have so much time, so let's...
Thank you so much for your talk. I mean, you also mentioned that you were not sure about the intention or what is actually then the purpose of this for the forest itself, I guess. And I'm just curious about what your thoughts are in the mutation of the relationship of forest to human through this changing of the forest as becoming like a competitor in the market, in the financial market, how that will change our interaction with the forest, and especially almost like in a spiritual sense, like how do we then relate to something that we usually worship in a way in many cultures, then as a competitive agent. In this sense, have you thought of this at all?
I mean, for the last question, I think, for example, one possibility to interact with the forest would be that the forest might employ you at one time. So this just like reverse like the normal or usual interaction with like a in a wider sense like a thing. Like a non-human entity.
I mean, we kind of also see this as a decentering of like the human, like becoming not like the owner, but like kind of interacting with the thing as a peer, you know. So it's probably more about like leveling the relationship between like agents, which we are once an agent, but also the natural system is kind of an agent. But before, like, we kind of, like, on the economic level, we kind of not interacting with this at all. So we kind of, like, thinking of, like, giving this kind of, like, a level out, in my opinion.
I think I have maybe one suggestion. There's a nice book called How Forests Think.
Yeah, we actually...
And for me, it works just to have that in the cupboard, and you know, the title is enough. but that's in a way that's you're wondering what does the forest want with its money?
Do you have a reply for that? No. I think we just have enough time for the final question. Who was it?
Yeah, it's kind of what you touched on. Like, there's a lot of talk about the forest accumulating capital and kind of like accumulating enough capital to kind of buy more forest. But I mean, a lot of people have kind of already touched on it, so it's kind of more needless complication, I guess. But like, should your forest like emancipate itself from capital? Like, you've got this kind of like post-human sort of world going on in this kind of project, should your forest?
I mean, it kind of does at one point, because it could at one point just not sell lock licenses anymore, right? So it will be like, fuck, I kind of like own myself, so like I don't need to interact anymore with anyone, which is then kind of a way of like like a really like long-term way of like nature preservation in the end.
I think that was it's a good time to close the session. Thank you all for being here today, and thank you for sharing your works with us.